Sotiris from SepticFlesh, and next Friday night I will be live at dmetalgalaxy group to discuss about SepticFlesh. So don't forget to join us at 11 Greek time, 9 Irish time.
Dive in the SepticFlesh as we are here for SepticFlesh. So what I notice is the band is atmospheric symphonic death metal. So can you explain more about this?
Yes, I always had a problem to explain our music from our beginning. So it was impossible to use only one word. We had at first we said the dream emotional death metal and stuff like that. Because actually we never intended to belong in a strict category of metal music and in music in general. Because we're listening to a lot of different kinds of music. Mm-hmm. We're listening to soundtracks. We're listening to gothic. We're listening to death metal, black metal, traditional heavy metal, rock. You know, a lot of different. Styles.
Yeah.
However, with the passing of time, we have developed our own sound and has some specific characteristics. For example, the metal element is very strong and towards the extreme. We have a very brutal vocals, with, Spiros or Seth.
Yes.
Also, we have the contrast with my vocals that are clean and have a more metallic element, mm-hmm. and also at some points some gothic atmospheres. And of course, besides the traditional rock metal instruments, we have a whole orchestra in our disposal. So we experiment with the atmosphere, that is the other element of our music. And we combine the fist to your face element with the atmosphere that you are in a coma, you know, and you dream. So we have two different worlds combined.
But the orchestra is not always present, right?
From Communion and after, it is... always present in the albums, but of course not in all the songs and not all the time. Actually, we decide at the end, you know, when we have all our elements, before we send them to the for the mixing process. We do a lot of pre-production ourselves, you know, to see how it will sound. And when we have the actual recordings, we make a meeting all together, mm-hmm. and we take the final decisions. So there are cases that songs started, for example, with guitar and ended with violin parts. Mm-hmm. Or we have parts that at first were it had to be played from violin and at we decided that we will be played from the guitar. You know, mm-hmm. there are decisions like that. And the decisions are based on the whole experience. You know, because when you have the whole picture, you must decide who is your protagonist. Because we have a lot of elements. And so we try to have a dynamics to our songs, so they won't be flat. You know, if you have an orchestra from point one to zero, to from point zero to the end, mm-hmm. You have a kind of a flat element. If you put the orchestra clever in parts that you emphasize the emotions or you emphasize the war feeling, mm-hmm. It's better. So the main element, of course, is the metal element. And then there are the points that the orchestra elevates the songs, putting more layers and putting different sound colors for the listener.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this, as you said, SepticFlesh is not only metal, it's different genres like goth, like symphonic, classical. So do you have any bands to tell us to influence?
Yes, of course. Yeah. Like, you know, music is not something that comes out from thin air.
Yeah.
it is something that existed and was transmuted mm-hmm. to something new, and then someone else continues this transmutation. And so actually it is the influence, you know, at first, and then the influence slightly changes and becomes something more personal mm-hmm. with identity. But all musicians and composers were influenced from something before them. That's a fact. Our favorite bands, some from our favorite bands, for example, vary from Bathory, Iron Maiden, Death, mm-hmm. Obituary, Morbid Angel,
okay.
So many bands. Paradise Lost, you see such a long difference between the bands.
Yeah, that's
it. Dead Can Dance.
Okay.
Yes, also, you know, rock like David Bowie, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And of course, there are a lot of classical and neoclassical influences,
mm-hmm.
like Stravinsky. Also, we listen to a lot to soundtrack music,
mm-hmm.
and composers like Danny Elfman, for example, Basil Boliduris. So, a very wide
list
of influences.
Yeah,
and very different styles as well.
Very different styles.
Yes.
Oh, I can see where SepticFlesh is coming. So, the protagonist. What I saw that the protagonist, and there is some mythology in the songs. You have Prometheus, Anubis, and so on. So I wonder what's the reason into mythology.
Probably, it is the way that we grew up in many ways. Because, for instance, I don't know if you have visited Greece. When you are in Greece, there are a lot of places that the past is in front of you. You see it, you know, you see all the ancient temples and the ruins, and also from school, you learn about the mythology, the Greek mythology. And it's very easy to be influenced from this element. And personally, as I'm responsible for writing the lyrics for the band, I always had an interest for the past of humanity, and I extended the interest beyond the Greekos, the Greek mythology, and I went further back, and was necessary to pass through Egypt, and find, you know, the basis for many myths and religions. For example, the Christian religion has a lot of influences from the Egyptian myths. A lot of components.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, going further back, before Egypt, you find Sumeria, find other civilizations, and there is a chain, there is a link. And of course, there are other interesting civilizations all around the world. And it's a very interesting trip, you know, to try to learn about the past. And the myths were the first efforts of the people of the ancient times
mm-hmm.
to present their opinion about how the world works. to pose questions about what happens after life, you know, the element of death, you know, and it's very interesting, you know, to see all those elements combined from a wider perspective. I think this is the key, not to be inside of it, be outside of it and see it as a wholeness.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the lyrics point is clear, but can you say, explain to us how it connects atmospheric and so on to the music itself, the themes?
Yeah, yeah. Always when we start writing, composing a new album, I put my ideas on a paper, subjects that I really like and want to discuss, my emotions, you know, topics in general that I find interesting. This is the first step. But then it's the step that I have also the music in my disposal, you know, from all the composers of the band. And then I discuss with the other guys about my ideas and I make my proposals, specific songs, to combine specific ideas of mine and lyrics. And there is the point, you know, that I start limiting my pool of ideas, more focused.
Okay.
And when we feel that the lyrics connect really, really well to the general emotion of the song, then I focus on the details of the lyrics, also in a very interacting also with Spiros, that is, you know, the main vocalist. Because I want his opinion about the phrases, about how we will sing on the songs. And then we have the final result, you know, the final lyrics that you listen when you play our albums.
Cool. So it's a whole process. It takes some time. It's
a lot of time, a lot of time. And it is, you know, also painful because I have to sacrifice some elements for the general good. I don't write a book. this is always the discussions I have with Spiros. He says, we don't write a book because, you know, I have so many ideas, so many stuff going on. And I have to decide what to put in and what to leave out, you know.
Yeah.
Cool. So you do many stuff, as you said. You write lyrics, you are a clean singer, a clean vocalist, you play guitar, you're one of the original...
All of us do a lot of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
All of us.
But also you have the... how can I say? You have the thing that you cannot travel with the band, always.
Yes, yes.
That is... what is the feeling about this? You do everything, you know, in the band and after, you know, because of your obligations, you cannot travel to many
places. Yes. It's strange. I feel strange, you know, to see the band playing live, to see, you know, videos from YouTube, to see, you know, people reacting to the live shows.
And you're not there.
Yes, it's very, very, very strange. However, it's the way that we're working for many, many years. I cannot follow such long tours because, you know, in the past I was on the tours because they were very, very limited.
Yeah.
It's another thing to do 30 days and another to do 100 days or 200 days per year.
Depends where you go.
Yes, yes.
If it's a US tour or...
Yes, they do actually 1-2 US tours per year. Of course, not now with the COVID thing, yes. But, you know, a lot of live shows to be performed. So I feel strange. However, on the other hand, my basic need is to express myself, you know, and as I do it with my lyrics and my music, I'm satisfied because what remains at the end is the music.
Yeah.
So I have the most important factor.
So, yeah, you miss a lot of a lot of stuff from the tours.
Yes.
Yeah.
From time to time, I have the pleasure to do some special shows. Like, mm-hmm, for example, the show that was captured on the DVD.
Yeah.
So I get also some small idea what it is to be on stage with the other guys.
So you have visited any countries or only like a few because you can tour?
I like to travel besides, mm-hmm, you know, touring and besides my experience with the band.
Mm-hmm.
I love to travel around the world. I have done a lot of trips. I have been to Egypt, for example, alone to see, you know, to see the to witness, you know,
the pyramids of God,
the pyramids and everything else. A lot of countries I have been, and I intend to keep it that way, because you get something inside you when you travel, even if it is for a few days.
Mm-hmm.
What you get when you return your home, it's very precious. And you live in a different way. You have the chance to witness different lifestyles, different sceneries, mm-hmm, different people. And you know, as life is short, it's good to live it to the full.
Exactly. Yeah. There was a song about it. You have seen some countries also on tours, but I'm wondering, have you been ever to Ireland?
No, this is one of my mistakes that I did. I'm intending to correct. But I have been to England,
mm-hmm,
Scotland, you know, but not Ireland. And I want to be there because I have a good impression about Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
People have told me that it's very nice there. So it is one of the trips that I want to do in the future.
Yes, after COVID.
Yeah, and the main thing will be a SepticFlesh show as well.
Yes.
Bring the world.
That will be good to combine.
Combine, yeah, holidays and music.
Yeah, exactly. And then Ireland on the map. Sotir is coming to Ireland, one of the countries to join.
Good, Sotir. So, can we go to artwork now? Can you tell us about the artwork? Because as I checked the artworks of SepticFlesh albums, it's very, you know, eye-catching. So, can you tell us who is behind the artwork?
Yes. Spiros, mm-hmm, or Seth.
Okay.
If you like,
yes,
is the mind and the artist behind the whole concept of SepticFlesh.
Okay.
So we have the chance to be 100% in control of our art, of what we want to present to the people on the meanings. It's very important, I think, because, you know, when you give it to a third person that is not inside the band,
mm-hmm,
and has not an idea about what songs will sound, you know, doesn't know,
mm-hmm,
you can only give him general directions.
Yeah.
When you have someone inside the band, it's much easier to communicate and to calibrate, you know, the result,
mm-hmm,
and make something very tight. Because, you know, when you have the lyrics, the music, and the artwork together as one, so it's also for the audience more intense experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because you know, yeah, you have Spiros, as you said. So Spiros is for the whole albums, all the albums of SepticFlesh.
Spiros is a visual artist for many album covers.
Okay.
Of famous bands, like for example Paradise Lost.
Okay.
He's created a cover for Paradise Lost, for Exodus, for Camelot. For,
I didn't know that.
For many, many known bands.
Mm-hmm.
Not also an artist for covers. He's a painter. And from time to time, he makes, you know, a representation of his work in galleries, like in Paris, for example, and other places.
Okay.
So, you know, the main, you can say, the main job of Spiros is art.
Okay.
So,
great stuff.
So, if we look at production of albums and so on, I saw that there were like sometimes three albums, then one, and now there is a big one, Nuclear Black. So I was wondering, what's the story about it?
With the what's the story with the Nuclear Blast?
Well, more with the labels. Why do you sometimes have three, sometimes one, and now Nuclear Blast? So I was wondering, what's the decision making there?
Yes, we had a great relationship with Season of Mist.
Mm-hmm.
And we still have. You know, as our live album is released from Season of Mist, and has also all our back catalog. But you know, at some point, you have to make a decision about the future, and you see, you know, in which countries have the most promotion, and other countries that have not your pick, and you have. Ability to do more, you know. Mm-hmm. So as Nuclear Blast is a very big label,
biggest one.
Yes, exactly. And so we decided to join forces, and I think it's obvious that it is for the best interest of SepticFlesh, this union with Nuclear Blast.
Mm-hmm.
They expect a lot of from us. We expect a lot from them. So it's mutual. And we will see what will happen with the new album.
Yeah. So basically, it's adding more countries, more fans from all the world.
Yes. It's a strategic move for us.
Spreading SepticFlesh around the world, the globe, more. Cool.
Yes, exactly. So it doesn't sound nice, but it is.
So, Sotiris, as you speak about the new album, I know that you were all July, I think, in.
Yes.
In
Studios.
Terry, our good friend Terry.
Yes.
And you were working. Night, day and
night.
Or night and day, or day and night. So can you tell us a few words about the new album, if you can, or...
Yeah, you know, actually, before we even entered studio, we were working like lunatics from our homes, you know, with our home studios, and presenting ideas all members, you know.
Yeah.
Presenting their ideas, calibrating their ideas.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very, very long process before even we enter the studio. So I cannot remember another album that we have worked so hard, so very hard. So actually, when we entered studio, and when I entered, you know, and started the recording the guitar with Terry, it was a relief for me. Relief,
yeah.
Because my mind at this point was ready to explode. So when I recorded, you know, the guitar parts, that of course are very important for a heavy metal sound.
Okay.
And I finished, you know, the guitars, the guitar recordings. I had the chance to relieve my mind from this direction and focus more on the vocals and the lyrics. You know, the other step, the other necessary step. And the process continues in many levels and in many studios, not only one.
Okay.
Because, for example, recently there were the recordings of the orchestra that happened in Prague.
Okay.
And Chris has this under his control, and he, under his, he was supervising everything. So it's also something for the rest of us. We don't have also to think about the orchestra. We have someone focused on the orchestra. And at the same time, you know, I was every day communicating with Spiros. I was sending him lyrics. He was making demos with, you know, how he imagines, you know, the vocals, how he would sing the vocals. And at the same time, Cream, our drummer, was traveling in Sweden, record there in the studio in Sweden, the drums. You imagine how it is, you know, when you are divided in three different areas.
Countries.
Yes.
And countries.
And everybody, and we work, you know, like ants. You know, collective like ants, you know, all together. So, each member doing his stuff.
I have lyrics, you have vocals, I have the drums.
Yes. So...
But this is a good thing.
Yes, we are in a very good place right now with the recordings. Most of the parts are recorded. We have a lot of work to do with the orchestra because there are so many channels, over 300 channels of classical instruments.
Oh my God.
you imagine that this must be okay.
Yes.
Put in categories in of instruments, and we must make decisions about which instrument must be louder, and you know, stuff like that.
Yes.
And then when we'll finish with this process, and we have also to record the vocals, because we leave the vocals at the end to have as much as possible the final result when we sing. You know, we want to listen to the orchestra.
Yeah.
We want to listen to everything, and then record the
final part,
the vocals, and then you know, we make the final strategic decisions when we have everything, and we will send to James Bogren all the stems to do the mix, and then we are over. We can relax.
So we have actually a viewer's question for the same topic.
Hello,
Benoit. I'm appeared. So a question from Russia, from Alexander Smirchov, wants to know what historic timeline will the new album have, like a past, present, or future?
Not only one theme in the album. There are themes focused on the present. There are some songs more futuristic, and there are songs that not I would say from the focusing on the past, but have mythological elements. But this time the elements are blended in an occult perspective. So there is, for example, one song. I won't reveal the title for the time being, but I will give some hints.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you see the title of the song, you may imagine that it is a song about, for example, a serial killer. You know, it's not directing to what it has to say from the first view. But when you read the lyrics, you see that it's quite a different story. And the story is, has a lot of Egyptian magical elements, mm-hmm. but presented from this timeline, from the present, right now. So imagine someone living right now, using knowledge from the past in order to make something that will affect the future.
Cool. So, that's actually very interesting.
Yes, so the themes cannot be so easily put in one timeline. Mm-hmm. And also I can say that there are two songs that are twins. So it is also the music and the theme is divided. They have their own entity as songs. You can listen to them one at a time, mm-hmm. but you will notice that they have some main idea, musical idea behind them, mm-hmm. that is evolved from the first song to the second. That it is the big finish, you know, and also the story. You know, you have the first part of the story, and you have the ending.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Sounds so interesting. I already want to listen to them now.
Yeah, exactly. I'm getting hungry for the new album.
And Alexander had a second question relating to the new album. So will there be a making of video of the new album?
I think so, because we have a lot of shots, you know, from video and from the orchestra. From the recordings of the orchestra and from the studio. So I believe that, I don't know if we will make it as a documentary altogether, if we put, you know, part by part, but we have footage to show. So in time, you will find out.
Cool.
But there is footage.
So for now, just have this hint, think about it. So now we are going to some older music. Like I saw the Dante's Inferno song and I was very interested in this. And I'm wondering, how did it fit into your music?
The story of
La Divine Comedia.
You know, it's... As I said before, I always wanted to present the story of Dante, because it's really dark, you know, and hellish. And I just wanted the perfect song to present the story. And it was one of my ideas that were never realized until I felt it was the right timing. And with the specific song, I imagined, you know, this actually, you know, this happens in a lot of songs, like for example, with Anubis and Persepolis. I try before connecting the music to the theme, I try to just, you know, I close my eyes and just listen to the music and start like dreaming, you know, like daydreaming and leave myself, you know, to try to imagine. Imagine like seeing, you know, a dream, and it comes out, you know, directly. You know, I feel that, you know, this song must have something in this direction, and that was also the case with Dante's Inferno.
Yeah, I imagine.
The difficulty is always to cut stuff out.
Yeah, exactly.
Because when you have such a long story. And you have to make only one song. Mm-hmm. You understand that it's very crucial what parts story to keep, to make it coherent, mm-hmm. and also make choices for the vocalist to be able
to sing
without telling too many unnecessary stuff.
Definitely, like there are 9 layers. I think there were 9 circles of punishment and so on. So it's like, where is the essence? Like, because it was like a big layer story. But also what I'm wondering is that for centuries, like translators have been struggling to interpret the poem and write something that it's close to original. So I'm wondering, when you were writing the song and so on, so how did you tackle this difficulty?
How long? I didn't listen to the question.
So what I'm wondering, because if you look at Dante's Inferno, it's very complex. And I know there is an Italian version, but like translators have tried to put a proper translation into English and so on. And
they wrote
notes. So I'm wondering, when you were like doing the song and so on, how difficult was it to understand what poem was saying, and how difficult was it to put it into a song?
Yes, actually, I enjoy the process. I enjoy the difficulty because I have the chance to do a research about the theme. It's different to read something casually.
Strange.
Yes, and different to try to understand it, to try to read between the lines. And I also, in the specific case of Dante's Inferno, I also tried to look the ancient writing. You know, I searched and found some translations. You know, there are differences indeed. And, you know, also at some point I was thinking to put some words in the Latin. You know, it was so difficult to put everything together that I decided, you know, to focus on plot elements. Mm-hmm. I decided to focus in specific zones of hell, you know, and to present, you know, the journey. The main character, the journey, and the end, that it's in the deeper, in the final level of hell. So it was difficult indeed, but I really enjoyed it.
How long did it take you?
When I work the lyrics, there are months of work, and not of course from morning to night. Months, you know. I start today. I make a research, and you know there are many cases that I did the research and never created lyrics. It's a lot of time consuming. Also with the songs, I wrote a lot of songs that are not in the album. All of us, you know, you have to pass through a process.
Yeah, exactly.
First, that it's a long process, and you don't know if you will use everything or nothing at all. But you have to go through this process, and it's necessary. And this process is really really long process. And you know, when you are on the final stage, like I said, and you have to make the final decisions, even then you are working. For instance, now I have one song that some parts are difficult for Spiros, you know, to say with brutal voice. I have to trim them down, so my work is not ended until the end. Long process.
Very, very long.
Oh yeah. And about the video, so there was a 360 immersive YouTube video where you can click with the mouse and you could zoom in and so on. So I'm wondering why the 360 video for this particular song and any hidden message there?
You mean the video that You feel that, like you are in a nightmare?
Like in Dante's Inferno, video, because it was like, I was very interested because I could click, drag, it was like, yay!
Yes. Well, actually, this is the artwork of Spiros, and it was an attempt to put the audience inside the art, you know, because as you turn around, you have this illusion that you go inside of it. Mm-hmm. So you can click on the many details, because Spiros probably is a lunatic. There's a lot of hidden details that you cannot see at first. And when you search around, if you magnify stuff, you will find a lot of stuff going on. Mm-hmm. So we thought it would be interesting to experiment with that. And that was the case. Maybe we will do it also for the future, because, you know, it was a primitive experiment. Maybe we can do it more. It was not so organized, you know. It had not many layers. Maybe we can do something more complicated in the future.
Before I go to the next question, I would like to ask about the nicknames. You have Anunnaki, and Spiros have Seth Zero. Can you tell us a bit?
I don't know about Spiro. Uh-huh. I know that he likes, you know, Seth and, you know, the stuff. Zero, you know, Spiro without the P, it's a zero. Okay. I don't know. You know, actually, the nicknames